The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita, as it is, 6th chapter, text number 13 through 15, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in February of 1969 in Los Angeles.
Sankhya Yoga is the Ashtanga Yoga. This sitting posture and meditation, this is called Sankhya Yoga. And Jnana Yoga means through philosophical process, by analytical process, what is Brahma and what is not Brahma, meeting, that is Jnana Yoga. Just like Vedanta Sutra, the Jnana Yoga. You study Vedanta Sutra, they say, Janma Adasya Jataha, we give one hint, quote, that the Supreme Brahma, Absolute Truth is there, from whom everything is emanating. Now we try to understand what must be there. That is explained in the Srimad Bhagavata. What is nature of that Absolute Truth? The Absolute Truth in the first verse of Srimad Bhagavata, which is said, Janma Adasya Jataha, Annayat Itaratascha Arthesu Avijna Sarat. Now, the Absolute Truth, if he is the supreme cause of all emanation, then what are the symptoms? The Bhagavad says that he must be a cognizant. He is not dead. He must be cognizant. And what kind of cognizance? Annayat Itaratascha Arthesu. Just like I am cognizant, you are also cognizant. But I do not know myself how many hairs are there in my body. I am claiming this is my head. But if I ask anybody, do you know how many hairs you have got in your body? That kind of knowledge is not knowledge. But the Supreme, Bhagavad says that He knows everything, directly and indirectly. I know I am eating, but I do not know how my eating process is helping my circulation of blood, how it is being transformed, how it is working, how it is going through the veins. I do not know anything. But God must be He who knows everything, every corner of His creation, what is going on, He must know. Therefore, the Bhagavata explains that Supreme Truth, from whom everything is emanated, He must be supremely cognizant. Cognizant. Avijna. Avijna means cognizant. That you may question, then if He is so powerful, wise and cognizant, He must have learned it from similar. No. He says that if He learns knowledge from somebody else, then He is not there. Sara, automatically. He is self-independent. This is a Jnana Yoga. To study what is the nature by just analyze what should be the nature of the Supreme from whom everything is emanating. That is explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Therefore, Srimad Bhagavatam is the Supreme Jnana Yoga and Bhakti Yoga combined. Yeah. Jnana Yoga process means to search out the Absolute Truth or to understand the nature of the Absolute Truth by philosophical. And this is called Jnana Yoga. And our is Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga means the same. Process is the same. Target is the same. One is trying to reach the supreme ultimate goal by philosophical way. One is trying to concentrate his mind on the Supreme, and the other, the bhaktas, they are simply engaging themselves to serve the Supreme Lord, so He reveals. One process is to understand by the ascending process, and another process is the descending process. Just like in the darkness, if you try to understand what is sun by ascending process, by flying your very powerful aeroplane or Sputnik, just go round over the sky, you cannot see. By the descending process, when the sun rises, you understand easily. Ascending process, my endeavor, inductive process. Just like my father says, then man is mortal. I accept it. Now if you want to study whether man is mortal, you study, you see many thousands of men, whether he is immortal or mortal, that will take so much time. But if you take the knowledge from the superior authority that man is mortal, your knowledge is done. So, athapi te deva padam bujadvaya prasada leshanu grihita evai janati tattvam bhagavan mahimna nasyanna ekopi chiram vichinna. Therefore this said, my dear Lord, a person who has received a little favor from you, he can understand you very quickly. And others who are trying to understand you by the ascending process, they may go on speculating for millions of years, they will never understand. They'll never understand. They'll come to the point of frustration and confusion. Oh, God is zero, that's all. Finish. If God is zero, then how from zero so many, figures coming up? God is not zero. Then Bhagavata says, Vedanta says, Janmadasya. Everything is generated from the Supreme. Now you have to study how it is generated. That is also explained. What is the way, what is the process, how to know it. This is Vedanta Sutra. The Vedanta means ultimate knowledge. Veda means knowledge. And Anta means ultimate. The Vedanta means ultimate knowledge. The ultimate knowledge is the Supreme Lord. Yes. Yes, that I have explained, that you have to simply serve him, then he will reveal. You cannot understand Krishna by your ascending process. You have to serve Krishna and Krishna will reveal to you. That is stated in the Bhagavad Gita, you will find in the same chapter. Tesham Ivanukam Partham. अहम अज्ञानजन तम नाशयामि आत्मभावस्त ज्ञान दीपेन भास्त दोज हु आर ऑलवेज एंगेज्ड इन माय सर्विस जस्ट टू शो देम स्पेशल फेवर तेषाम अनुकंपात अहम अज्ञानजन तम नाशयामि आई वैंक्विश ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ डार्कनेस ऑफ इग्नोरेंस बाय द लाइट ऑफ नॉलेज. So Krishna is within you, and when you are sincerely searching after Krishna by the devotional process, as it is stated in the Bhagavad Gita, you will find in the 18th chapter, Bhaktyamavijana. One can understand me simply by this devotional process, Bhaktya. And what is Bhakti? Bhakti is this, Savanam Kirtanam Vishnu, simply hearing and chanting about Vishnu. This is the beginning of it. So if you simply hear, sincerely and submissive, then you will understand Krishna. Krishna will reveal to you. Savanam, Kirtanam, Krishna, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasam, there are different nine kinds of variety. So, Vandanam, offering prayer, that is also bhakti. Savanam, to hear about it, just like we are hearing about Krishna from this Bhagavad Gita. Chanting about His glory, Hare Krishna. This is the beginning. Savanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu. Vishnu means this, everything is Vishnu. The meditation is Vishnu. The bhakti is Vishnu. Not without Vishnu. And Krishna is the original form of Vishnu. Krishna is the Bhagavan Swayam. The original form of the Supreme Personality of God. So, if we follow this process, then we can understand without any doubt.
One should hold one's body, neck and head erect in a straight lounge, and stare steadily at the tip of the nose. Thus was an unagitated, subdued mind, devoid of fear, completely free from self-doubt. One should meditate upon me within the heart and make me the ultimate glory of life.
This is the process. First of all, we have to select a nice place, solitary place, and you have to execute alone. Not that you go to a yoga class and pay your fees and make some gymnastics and come back home and do all nonsense. You see? Don't be entrapped by all these ridiculous things. Simply, with such society, I can declare, is the society of the cheaters and the cheaters. You see? Here is the practice. Here you can see, and spoken by the supreme authority, Krishna. Is there any person better yogi than Krishna? Here is the authoritative statement that you have to practice like this. Now, one should hold one's body. First of all, you have to select your place, holy place, alone, and special feet. Then you have to sit straight like this. One should hold one's body, neck and head erect, a straight line. This is the yoga practice. These things help to concentrate the mind. That's all. But the real purpose of yoga is to keep Krishna always within your thought. Here it is stated that one should hold one's body, neck, and head erect in a straight line, and stare steadily at the tip of the nose. Now, here, you have to see, and if you close meditation, you sleep. I have seen so many so-called meditators, they are sleeping. I have seen it. Because as soon as you close your eyes, it is natural that you feel sleepy. Therefore, half closed, you have to see, that is the process, you have to see the tip of your nose, two eyes. Thus, with unagitated mind, this process will help your mind to be fixed up. Unagitated mind, subdued mind, devoid of fear. Yeah. Because you have to generally, the yogis, they used to practice in jungle. And if he's thinking of some tiger is coming or not, oh, what is that? Or some snake is coming. Because you have to sit down alone in a jungle. You see? There are so many animals, tigers and deers and snakes. So, therefore it is specially stated, devoid of fear. skin of deer is specially used in yogasana because it has got some medical effects that snakes do not come. If you sit down on that particular skin, the snakes and reptiles will not come there. That is the problem. Will not be disturbed. Devoid of fear, completely free from sex life. You see, if you indulge in sex life, you cannot fix up your mind in anything. That is the effect of brahmachari life. If you remain brahmachari without sex life, then you can be determined. Just like we have seen a practical example of Mahatma Gandhi in India. Now, he started a movement, non-violent, non-cooperation. The movement, the fight was declared against the powerful British Empire, just see. And he determined that I shall fight with the Britishers non-violent, without any weapon, because India was dependent, there was no weapon. And several times it was attempted by armed revolution. But these Britishers are more powerful, they cut down. So Gandhi, he invented this method that I shall fight with the Britishers, even they become violent, I shall not become violent, so I shall get world sympathy. So this was his plan. He was a great statesman. But his determination was so fixed up because he was a brahmachari. From at the age of 36 years, he gave up. He had his wife, but he gave up his sex life. He was a family man. He had children, he had his wife. But from the age of 36, young man, 36-year-old, he gave up sex life with his wife. That made him so determined that I shall drive away these Britishers from the land of India, and he did it. And he actually did it. So, controlling the sex life, to refrain from sex life is so powerful. Even if you don't do anything, if you simply restrain your sex life, you become a very powerful man. People do not know the secret. So, anything you do, if you want to do it with determination, you have to stop sex life. That is the secret. So any process takes basic process. Either you take yoga process or bhakti process or jnana process, in no process sex indulgence is allowed. No. Sex indulgence is only allowed family life just to beget very nice children. That's it. Sex life is not for sense enjoyment. Although there is enjoyment by nature, unless there is enjoyment, why one should take responsibility of family life? That is the secret of nature's gift. But we should not take advantage of it. These are the secrets of life. These are the secrets of life. So yoga practice, such a nice thing, if you indulge in sex life, this is simply nonsense. Simply nonsense. And if anyone says that you go on with your sex life as much as you like, at the same time you become a yogi, simply pay my fees, I give you some miracle mantra. These are all nonsense. They are all nonsense. But we want to be cheated. We want to be cheated. We want something sublime, very cheap. That means we want to be cheated. If you want very nice thing, you must pay for it. No, I shall go to a store I can pay you 10 cents. He's giving me the best. How can you expect by 10 cents? If you want to purchase some value, if you want to purchase gold, then you have to pay for it. Similarly, if you want perfection in yoga practice, then you have to pay for it like this. Don't make it childish affair. That is the instruction of Bhagavad Gita. If you make it childish affair, then you'll be cheated. And so many cheaters are ready to cheat you and take your money and go out. That's all. Here is the statement, authoritative statement. Free from sex life, one should meditate upon me. And ultimately, where is the meditation? Not in void. Just on Vishnu, this Vishnu form, that is Sankhya Yoga. This Sankhya Yoga was first practiced by Kapila Dev, the incarnation of God, Krishna. So, this is the secret of yoga, that this, process of sitting and seeing the tip of your nose and sitting straight, all these means will help you to concentrate your mind on the Vishnu form or Krishna. One should meditate upon me. This meditation means meditation on Krishna. So here in this Krishna consciousness movement, it is directly, simply on Krishna. There is nothing. Therefore, nobody is better meditator than this boy. That simply concentrating on Krishna. The whole business is Krishna. They are working in the garden, digging the earth. There will be nice rose we shall offer to Krishna. Meditation. Practical meditation. I shall grow rose and it will be offered to Krishna. Even in the digging there is meditation. You see? They are preparing nice foodstuff. It will be eaten by Krishna. So in cooking there is meditation. You see? And what to speak of chanting and dance? So they are meditating 24 hours in Krishna. Perfect yoga. Let anyone come and challenge. These boys are perfect yoga. We are teaching perfect yoga system. Not whimsically on the authority of Bhagavad Gita. We have not manufactured anything by concoction. But here is the state. Simply to concentrate your mind on Krishna or Vishnu. And their activities have been so molded that they cannot think of Krishna, cannot think but Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. So the highest meditation, think upon me within the heart and make me the ultimate goal of life. So that Krishna is the ultimate goal of life. They are preparing for themselves for being transferred to the Krishna law. So here is perfect yoga. Perfect yoga they are practicing. So,
verse 15. When meditating in this manner, always controlling the body, mind, and activities, the mystic transcendentalist attains to see the supreme nirvana which abides in me.
Nirvana means? The actual word nirvana, Sanskrit, nirvana means finish. Finish! That is called nirvana. That means materialistic activity is finished. Nama! That is called nirvana. And unless you finish this nonsense activity, see, there is no question of peace. So long if you engage in materialistic activities, there is no question of peace. Prahlad Maharaj said to his father, Tatsadhu manne suravadjati hinam sada samadhumadra dhyam asad graha. His father asked him, my dear boy, you are being educated, a small boy, 5 years old, father is always affectionate. And he was asking, my dear boy, what you have learned, best thing till now? Oh, immediately, yes, Father, I shall tell you the best thing. What is that? He said, Tat sadhu manne suravardhati hina. My dear Father, this is the best thing. For whom? Best thing for whom? He said, Tat sadhu manne suravardhati hinaam sada samudvigna dhyam asadgrahat. These people, these materialistic people, who have accepted something non-permanent, just try to understand each word. These materialistic people, they are hankering after capturing something non-permanent, that's all. We have seen by experience now that President Mr. Kennedy, he was a very rich man, he wanted to be president, and he spent money like anything. He became president, he had his nice family, wife, children, presidency, finished, he's a second. Similarly, everyone is trying in the material world to capture something which is non-permanent. But I am spirit, soul, permanent. So these rascals, they do not come to sense that I am permanent, why I am after non-permanent. If I am always busy for comforts of this body, but I know that this body, today or tomorrow or 100 years after will be finished. And so far I am concerned, I am spirit, soul, I have no birth, I have no death. Then what is my function? It is the bodily function. So far I am doing this material activity. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj said, asabgraha. Just see how nice. They are anxious. They are full of anxiety because they have captured something non-permanent. Their whole activities are targeted to capture something non-permanent. Therefore, they are always full of anxiety. Any person, any living entity, man, beast or animal or gods, always anxious. This is material disease. So, if you are always full of anxiety, where there is question of peace? I go in the street and say, beware of dog. They are living in a very nice house, but full of anxiety. Somebody may not come. Let there be dog. You say, beware of dog. No trespass. That means, although living in a nice cottage, very nice, but full of anxiety. Full of anxiety. Sitting in an office, very nice, good salary, always thinking, I may not lose this office. American nation, very rich nation, very good defense force, everything, always anxious, the Vietnamese may not come here. So who is free from anxiety? Therefore, the conclusion is, if you want peace without anxiety, then you have to come to the Krishna consciousness. There is no other alternative. It is practical. Just try to understand. Therefore, here it is said, by meditating in this manner and meditating upon me, Krishna, always controlling the body, the first control is tongue. And the next control is the genital. Then you control everything. You give your tongue engagement for chanting and eating Krishna prasad. It is control. And as soon as your tongue is controlled, immediately your stomach is controlled, immediately next your genital is controlled. Simple thing. Controlling the body. Mind, Mind being fixed of Krishna, no other engagement. Control. Activities, always doing Krishna's work. Gardening, typing, cooking, working, everything for Krishna. Activities. The mystic transcendentalist, then immediately they become mystic transcendentalist, attains to peace, the supreme nibbana, which abides in me. It is only in Krishna. You cannot find out peace outside Krishna activities, outside Krishna consciousness. That is not possible.
Wrong. Before, the goal in practicing yoga is not pleasing.
Now, clearly expressed. What is the purpose of yoga? They are very much proud of becoming yogi and attending yoga society and this and that and meditation. But here is the yoga practice. Clearly expressed. But
yoga practice is not meant for attaining any kind of material facility. It is to enable the cessation of all material existence.
So long, he requires some material facility. He'll get material facility, but that is not solution of the problems of your life. Material facilities, I think, you American boys and girls, you have got material facility better than any other nation, at least better than India, that I can say by my experience. And I have traveled so many countries, in Japan also I have seen, but still you are better positioned. But do you think you have attained peace? Can any one of you say, yes, I am completely in peace? Then why the youngsters are so much frustrated and confused? So long we shall utilize this yoga practice, this practice as for some material facility, there is no question of peace. Yoga practice should be performed to understand Krishna, that's it. Or to make your lost relationship with Krishna re-established. That is yoga practice.
One who seeks an improvement in health or aspires after material.
Generally, this yoga practice goes on in the name of improving health. Somebody goes to deduce fat. You see? Reduce fat because you are rich less and you eat more and become fatty. And then again pay yoga practice fee and reduce your fat. Yeah, that is it. I have seen some advertisement. Yeah, that's it. Reduce your fat. Why you increase your fat? The nonsense they will not understand. See, if I have to reduce it, why I increase it? Why not be satisfied with simple foodstuff? If you eat grains and vegetables, a light foodstuff you'll never get fat. You see? You'll never get fat. Reduce eating as much as possible. Don't eat at night. Practice yoga like this. If you become bhoresa sita, you'll be. There are two kinds of diseases. The bhoresa sitas, they are attacked with diabetes, and those who cannot eat sufficiently, they are tuberculosis. So you cannot eat more or you cannot eat less. You just eat what you require. If you eat more, then you must be diseased. And if you eat less, you must be diseased. That will be explained. Yukta ahara viharasta yoga bhavati sindhu. You are not to starve. But don't eat more. Our program, Krishna Prasadam, is that you eat Krishna Prasadam. Eating is required. You have to keep your body fit for any practice. So eating is required. But don't eat more. Eat, don't eat less also. You don't say that you eat less. If you can eat 10 pounds, eat. But if you cannot eat 10 pounds out of avarice, out of this greediness, if you eat 10 pounds, then you'll suffer. You see? So, Here is there. What is that? No material facility.
The Bhagavad cessation of material existence does not mean entering into an existence of void, which is only a myth.
So, cessation of material existence does not mean void. Because I am not void. I am spirit soul. If I was void, how my development of this body has taken place? I am not void. I am the seed. Just like you sow a seed on the ground, it grows into large tree or plant. Similarly, the seed is given by the father in the womb of the mother, and it goes like a tree. And this body is there. Where is wordness? Ahanga bija pada pita. In the 14th chapter, you see that originally the seed was given by Krishna in the womb of this material nature, and so many living entities are coming out. You cannot argue against it, because actually the generation is the same process as in our practical life. You see, the father gives the seed in the womb of the mother, and the mother, nourishes the child to grow forth. So there is no question of why. If the seed would have been void, how this nice body has developed? So, nirmala means not to accept any more material body. Don't try to make it void. That is another nonsense. Void, you are not void. Void means to make void this material body. The full of miserable conditional body. Just try to hold your spiritual body. That is possible. Jajjatyana nivartanti tadhyama paramahama. These things are there. So, we have to become very intelligent to understand what is the problem of life. How should we use this valuable human form of life? Unfortunately, this education is practically nil all over the world. Perhaps this is the only institution who is presenting the actual problems of life and actual value of life. It's just a consciousness movement. Right.
There is no void anywhere within the creation of the Lord. Rather, the situation in the
void, you see, anywhere, even within the ground, within the earth, you will not see anything void. On the earth, there is no void. In the sky, there is no void. In the air, there is no void. In the water, there is no void. In the fire, there is no void. Then where do you find void? Where do you find void? This void philosophy is another illusion. There cannot be any void. God.
Rather, the cessation of material existence enables one to enter into the spiritual sky, the abode of the Lord. The abode of the Lord is also clearly described in the Bhagavad Gita as that place where there is no need of sun or moon nor of electricity.
Now, in fine, in the Bhagavad Gita, we have already I think in the second chapter there is. Anyway, that it is said that na tatra bhasate surya na sasanka na pavaka jadgatyana nivartante tadhyama paramam mama. Now Krishna describes my abode, how it is. Now, that in that sky where my abode is there, there is no necessity of sunlight. There is no necessity of moonlight. There is no necessity of electricity. Now, you cannot find such abode within this universe. You travel with your Sputnik or any machine, you find out some place where there is no sunlight, there is no moonlight. The sunlight is so extensive all over the universe. Where do you find that place? That means that place is beyond the star. That is also stated. Parasasvastu bhava anya bhaktya bhaktya sanatana. Beyond this material nature, there is another spiritual nature. So we do not know what is the formation of this material nature and what to know about the spiritual nature. Then you have to hear from Krishna, he lives there. Otherwise he remains nonsense all your life. Here is information. How can you know, which you cannot reach, cannot know, your senses are so imperfect? How can you know? Simply you have to hear. Just like you have to hear about your father from the mother, there is no other way. The father sacrificed, mother sacrificed, here is your father, you have to accept. You cannot make any experiment beyond your means. Similarly, if you want to learn about the spiritual sky and God's kingdom, then you have simply hear from the authority. There is no question of experimental knowledge. Simply hear. So, hearing means just like you have to believe some gentleman as your father, hearing from the authority of your mother. Simply, from the Vedic literature, which is accepted as the mother, authority of mother, knowledge. Mother authority. Veda Mata, it is called Veda Mata. Veda means knowledge, and it is received from the mother. So, Veda Mata, the knowledge mother, you have to know what is Krishna. And here Krishna is personally explaining. So you have to believe. Then you get the knowledge. Otherwise there is no possibility. You cannot make any experiment. Then you fail. Wow.
All the planets in the spiritual kingdom are self-illuminated by the sun, which is material.
Okay. Because here, this planet, this earthly planet, is not illuminating. Therefore, he required the illumination by the sun, by electricity, by moon. But there, the planet, Krishna is self-effulgent. His planet is also self. One example is this sun. Sun is the self-illuminating planet. If in the material world there is possibility of this illuminating planet, what to speak of the spiritual world? All the planets they are illuminating. Self-illuminating. Just like jewel. Jewel, a diamond, a piece of diamond, you put it in the darkness, it is self-illuminating. There is no question of illumination to show, here is a diamond. It is self-illuminating. Even in this material world, you find. So, that planet, Krishna planet, Goloka Vrindavan, that is self-illuminating. We are giving that picture in our Srimad Bhagavatam. Self-effulgent. There are many millions of planets in that spiritual star. Wow.
God is everywhere, but the spiritual sky and the planets thereof, called
Param
Dhamma, the superior
home. Yes. This material world is also God's creation. This is also God's kingdom. But because we have forgotten God, we have made God is dead, therefore it has become hell. But if we accept God, it becomes spiritual world automatically. Therefore, this temple is spiritual world. It is not material world. It is above the material world.
A consummate yogi who is perfect in understanding Lord Krishna as is clearly stated herein by the Lord Himself can attain real peace and can ultimately reach the supreme abode, the Krishna Loka known as Goloka Vrindavan.
In the Brahma Samhita, it is stated that the Lord, although he resides always in his abode called Goloka, is the all-pervading Brahman and the localized Paramatma as well.
Yes. If you think that if Krishna is in his abode, Goloka Vrindavan, then how you think that in your temple there is Krishna? No, in the Brahma Samhita say, therefore we require to hear from the authorized Mahārāja. The Brahma Samhita says, Goloka eva nivasati akhilātma bhūto. Although he is living in his abode, Goloka Vrindavan, he is everywhere. He is everywhere. Just that the same example can be used. That sun is 90 million miles or something like that, away from us. But it is within your room. Otherwise, how you say, oh, sunlight is here? So if sun can penetrate within your room, cannot Krishna penetrate within your heart and room and empty corner? It's all useless. He's everywhere. But you have to realize how he's everywhere.
Yeah. Nobody can meet the spiritual sky or enter into the eternal abode of the Lord without the proper understanding of Krishna and his unary expansion of Vishnu. Therefore, a person working in Krishna consciousness is the perfect yogi because his mind is always absorbed in Krishna's activity. In the Vedas also we know, one can overcome the path of birth and death only by understanding the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In other words, the perfection of the yoga system is the attainment of freedom from material existence and not some magical jugglery or gymnastic feat to befool innocent people.
Thank you.